It's a long way from the crowds of the MCG, not to mention Lords, but this rural Victorian property links some of cricket's biggest names of the past three decades. Steve Waugh, Imran Khan, Brian Lara, Mohammad Azhruddin, Mike Hussey, and even our own Brendan Julian have all wielded bats handcrafted by Julian Millichamp. The clock on the side all says
11 degrees. Come up for your bat.
I have.
Okay.
What have you got for me?
Oh, we'll choose one out and we'll go from there and we'll make you a beauty.
Not all of Julian's clients are elite players, but they can all choose from hundreds of imported English willow clefts and have the bat tailored to their specific needs.
What sort of grade are you looking at? Are you looking at the very top grade or a lower grade?
Yep.
Okay, top grade. That sounds beautiful. They discovered willow in about 1750 and stuck with it ever since. And the willow itself is a very soft material and also very light. But by pressing the face and the edges, you're creating a very hard surface on a very open, soft, spongy material underneath. And that's what gives it its spring and its pliability.
It takes around 25 years of high maintenance and careful nurturing for an English willow tree to mature, and the grain of wood is one sign of its quality.
Well, it's one of the biggest myths in cricket that people seem to believe that the tighter the grain, the better the piece of wood. It's actually the opposite, that in the slightly wider grain pieces of wood is where you find most of your first grade wood, 7 to 9 grains, you'll get a longer lasting bat and beautiful playing pieces.
The bats are graded by the quality of the timber. A mallet ringing on a high grade cleft is sometimes described as sounding like a screaming cat, the inspiration for Julian's label. The craftsman has been in the business for 30 years and uses the same tools and methods that have been used for centuries.
The draw knife, it's a very traditional tool that's used by pod shavers. It's a hand tool, and what it does is remove a lot of wood very quickly, but with a great degree of accuracy. And this tool itself, they don't make them anymore. This would be probably from the turn of the century, very old steel. You have to look in antique shops to find these. I've had this since I was 16.
Bat makers are traditionally known as pod shavers, a reference to the block or pod of willow.
This is the horse's shin bone. It's a very old traditional polishing tool. Put about 60 metres of twine, gets wrapped onto the bat, and with the glue soaking into a cotton twine on the underneath and on the top side, it really should set really quite hard. But as the handle breaks in, you'll actually find that you still get plenty of movement.
With the rise of mass production and big sponsorship deals, the art of pod shaving is in danger of disappearing.
We're two true hand makers left now in Australia and probably a half a dozen in England. And I think you can pretty much say that's about it around the world. And now with the big larger brands and everything being taken offshore, I just think we could lose the traditional methods for good. And that would be a crying shame to lose something that's been around since the late 1600s, early 1700s. Just to have it disappear would be a crying shame.
Depending on the grade, a handmade bat costs between $300 and $700, which is less than some mass-produced brands. But the handcrafted bat comes with the advantage of custom features.
But with industrialisation and people turning on a lathe, the oval handle just died out and it became round. But with an oval handle, if you hit the ball slightly off centre of the bat towards the edges, the bat doesn't spin in your hands and you don't lose any power through your shot.
It's this kind of passion and knowledge that has attracted some legendary batsmen.
To have a player with an eye like Alan Gilchrist using your bats and putting the ball out of the park, something that you made, and you sit there and you say, look, that was just fantastic. But going right back in the older days, and even the Alan Lambs and Dean Jones and even Viv Richards I've made a bat for, and you watch some of those great players hit a ball and you think, yep, I made that bat. That's really what it's all about.
But seeing his work in the hands of a club cricketer is almost as satisfying.
I love making for people where you see the smile on their face and how animated they are and about how they love their bat so much. And obviously to watch it, specifically if you get it onto international television, to watch it scoring runs in the big stadium, then that's no great accolade. And you love that. Yeah, you never grow tired of watching your bats slog somebody out of the ground for six.
Catch!
Goes. And goes. And goes.
Yeah, great story. Thanks, Melinda, and also to Julian Millichamp. AB, that's it. That's the bat.
that was just made.
It's a big shack of willow, isn't it?
It's heavy, isn't it? I mean, batsmen, your thoughts? I mean, are they finicky with their bats?
All batsmen are a little bit finicky with their bats. This would be something that Junior could probably use. It's a bit heavy for me, but have a go at the willow and that. It's amazing how much wood they get in the bat these days.
Well, it's changed so much. I mean, if you look at the bats when we first played cricket, the edges were that wide. Now they're like that, and the balance and the weight in the bats is they're lighter.
Like the ones that you used to use? That was a personal plug early on in that, wasn't it?
I can't
believe it. You 16 in Test cricket, and we're plugging your bats.
Well, I only got these ones at the end. But Steve Waugh, and I can say this, that we had a bat, Julian Millichamp, which used to be Millichamp and Hall bat, autograph bat. And Stephen used it. He pulled it off and was going to sign it and went, oh, this looks all right. And walked out and had a hit with it. And it wasn't. It pinged off.
A few runs?
Can't remember how many runs he scored. But AB, what about the grain? I mean, I always thought that the thin grain was the go as well.
Yeah, well, I looked for thinner grains or more grains across the surface. What did he say there? Probably
between seven and eight, didn't he?
Seven and eight. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's perfect. Goody. So I would look for a sort of 10 plus.
But definitely the bats these days, Junior, the ball's going out of the ground a lot more.
Well, they're thicker. There's more willow and they're lighter, the way they compress the bats, I think. And the handle's got so much whip in them. So it's like golf clubs, isn't it? They're hitting them further and longer.
Well, some of us. now, what about the bats you used to have? They were a bit longer. Did you have a lower middle to your bat?
Not sure, but I used to have a long blade, which is about... I don't know about that much longer because I used to stand up quite tall and my stance just felt more comfortable to me. So I would have liked an extra wide one. That would have helped.
Yeah, that would have helped. Not for Viv, though. You must have thanked Julian for giving him a good bat when you were standing in the middle. He looked pretty happy.
That was a nice gesture as the ball was disappearing to all parts. I think Viv could have used the stump, though, the way he played at times. He was special. But, he used quite a light bat, Viv Richards, compared to some of the weights of, say, Tendulkar using a 3-pound type bat. I think Viv was a lot lighter than that, which is extraordinary because he's a strong bloke.
All right, we'll get that out a bit later on.